good news. Thanks for coming along. This is a new song called Fashion Fever.
In the Thank you. We'd like to play a new song now, off of our latest album. This is a song called Children to Say. I hope you're going to like it.
Say,
Thank you.
You're my
Franklin there on piano.
Hi, thank you. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much indeed. Leaving me now. We'd like to play a song. Do you want to sing? I said, do you want to sing? Yeah, you're damn right. We're going to sing at the spirit of the people. The rhythm has begun. This is the chant. We'll be right back.
Yeah. Sing! Give it up, give it up, give it up. Bye.
few sons and daughters, this is called Hot Water.
Wasting time is a primary us to our room. He'd be the voice of doom. He said that we would thank him later. All day he was solid as a rock, but by 8 o'clock we'd be crumbling. One night my brother Joe and me climbed down the family tree that grew outside our bedroom window. We ran though we knew it couldn't last, running from the past, things that we were born to be. Looking back it's so bizarre, it runs in the family. All the things we are, on the backseat of the car with Joseph and Emily. We only see so far, and we all have our daddy's eyes. Looking back it's so bizarre. Servant judge, a man so large, he barely fit his circumstances. He said two kids out on the street were picked up on the beaten in the station. So there's me with Emily and Joe and Daddy driving home, all heading in the same direction. He knew no matter what the brakes, we'd make the same mistakes. Couldn't take his eyes off Joe and me. Looking back, it's so bizarre, it runs in the family. All the things we are, on the backseat of the car, with Joseph and Emily. We only see so far, and we all have our daddy's eyes. Looking back, it's so bizarre, it runs in the family. All the things we are, looking back, it's so bizarre.
There was a very healthy music scene on the Isle of Wight, and three of the original lineup of Level 42 came from the Isle of Wight. There was Phil Gould, his older brother Boone Gould, who played guitar, Phil on drums, of course, and myself. We used to play together in bands on the island way back in 1974, 75, 76. And there was a fantastic, because the Isle of Wight was a holiday destination before sort of cheap flights and stuff when people started going away, there was a very healthy amount of holiday camps and bed and breakfast and things, and loads of pubs where sort of aspiring musicians could go and play. So there was a very healthy band scene, local band scene on the Isle of Wight. And it was very good to sort of cut your teeth on trying to become the best on the island, because it was, you know, it was a sort of a small boundary, so you could do that, you could aim to do that. I think the current guys that are having success is a band called the Bees. They've had some success recently, you know, and Craig Douglas, as you mentioned earlier on, the singing milkman. No, I think more filmically, we have Anthony Minghella, who's sort of a multi-Oscar winning guy. He's from the Isle of Wight. But the current scene, it, once again, is quite healthy. The pendulum seems to have swung back, and there seem to be a lot of bands. But I don't get out much, you know, anymore with the Zimmer frame access and all that. Well, good music is good music. And I mean, I'm a band guy. I like bands. I like the interaction between players and bands. And I think that the misnomer of these boy bands or girl bands where you have just vocalists, that they're not bands as far as I'm concerned. They're singers. And you know, you have some really fine singers, but it's not a band. A band does consist of instrumentalists and musicians that actually go to make the noise. You know, not some guys sitting at home facelessly working machines and the music suddenly magically appears from somewhere. Now, I'm a big band fan, but to get back to your question, that I can't think of any bands at the moment, with the exception of maybe the Mars Volta, I think, are quite exciting. And my son, Darcy, turned me on to them because they... And what was great was that when he sort of played this to me, you know, I mean, when you've been around a while, you have sort of quite a long experience to pull on. And when Darcy played me the Mars Volta stuff, and I sort of downloaded a couple of video shots from them on the web, you know, on the internet, it really put me in mind of Todd Rundgren's Utopia from back 1973 time. Just the approach and the way and the Mahavishnu Orchestra as well, because it's quite off the wall stuff and quite challenging. And it was great to be able to then say to Darcy, you know, because I said I really like this, you know, this is good stuff. And it, you know, if you like this, then you're going to like listen to this. And so to put on the Utopia stuff was just great. And since then, you know, Darcy said that's now one of his favourite albums. Another Live, it's called, from 1973. And it's great stuff, and it's sort of parallels. Now, that's not to say that there's only ever good stuff from the past and that you have to keep going back there. But because, of course, every generation, you know, you want to hear stuff now. You want to hear now music. You want to hear it from your peers and people that you can relate to, you know, not some sort of grisly old thing. But, no, you know, good music is good music. So if a band's happening, then that's it. And it's usually based around the drummer, I have to say, too. Good drummer makes a good band. The slap technique that I use, you know, I didn't invent. It's the slap has been around really since the days of upright bass, and it's just a very rhythmic way of playing. But I have been able to take it on a little further from the more sort of simplistic approach, and that really comes back to the drum thing again and being a drummer. That was what I started doing, and it, for me, it was really like drumming on the bass. It's two hands. It's a combination of two hands. You know, it's not quite so focused on the right hand. Yeah, it's the right thumb that does the smacking, but the damping and the percussion and the hammering ons that the left hand does go to combine, just as a drummer's, you know, both hands combine in a drum to make a drum pattern, and that's really the essence behind the whole thing. And I actually began. We're sitting in the Astoria Theatre here, and I began about 50 yards away across the road, Charing Cross Road, in Macari's Music Store. That's where I first picked up the bass and started playing. It was quite a late change for me. You know, I'd been drumming since the age of 9, and I didn't move here until I was 18, 19 years of age. So I sort of really started playing the bass around 19, 20 years old. Well, regret. I mean, it's very sad that the lineup, you know, that from the original lineup changed, and it was. Yeah, you know, because there is definitely a chemistry between that lineup. Just as, you know, I really believe there's a good chemistry between the lineup that I have now. But to answer your question too, I mean, the original lineup was particularly creative, and it just sounded like Level 42. I mean, there weren't any other bands that sounded like it. You know, and that was definitely a combination of five people actually. The fifth member being Wally Badru, who always played keyboards and. You know, produce the records for us in the studio. But, you know, you could waste a lot of time regretting things, you know. It's unfortunate. And in a lot of ways, we did what we did, and I'm really proud of those things too. So sometimes you can't go back and recreate it, you know. I mean, I would really have to ask myself, if the original lineup was to play now, would it be as good as the lineup that I currently have is, you know? And I'm not so sure that it would be, because it was fantastic at its time and it was of its time. But, you know, things change and people change. Well, I think that for the past 6 years, we haven't been working together live, and I mean, it's in 1994 is when we actually finished working together. That's not to say that we're not going to work together again, because I like Mike a lot, and I like all the guys a lot. You know, and you can never say never on these things. But, you know, it's once again, that too was of its time, you know. And I mean, Mike's sort of ploughing his own furrow now. And, you know, he's a fantastic musician, very talented. And, you know, he's just recently released a piano album. And he's newly married and he's just become a father, you know. So all of these things you have to make time and space for. And, you know, it's moved on. I'm not really regretful about, you know, too many things, because you know, you am what you is, and you is in the time that you am, and you know, that's fine. That's fine for me, really. But I love all the guys, and you know, if we ever get together again and play, well, you know, that'd be nice too. But I really love the lineup I've got at the moment. Oh, I tell you, it was so scary. You know, the Wembley show back in fact, this is right at the end of 1986. And we just had two unbelievably hectic years, because in 85 we recorded the World Machine album, which features Something About You and Leaving Me Now. And it was a very successful album for us, and we were seen to be continually touring. So much so that Polydor Records wanted to release another single, and they didn't particularly want to take it from the World Machine album. So in the interim, we went in the studio, in sort of between tours, we went in the studio and recorded Lessons in Love and Children Say and Freedom Someday, and then went immediately back out on the road again. And in the meantime, Polydor Records released Lessons in Love, which became a really big hit, in fact, our biggest hit. And this all culminated at the end of 1986 by doing our first shows at Wembley Arena. And I think they were going to be the first of, how many shows? We did an awful lot of shows there, you know, because we kept doing them in blocks of four, and then we do another four a few weeks later, and then we did another four, and then another four. And it was so scary, because it was a quantum leap. Although we'd been working a lot, and, you know, but this was the first time, and we'd done a lot of support tours as well, actually. We'd always, you know, we'd opened for Madonna and Steve Winwood and Tina Turner and the Police, and so big crowds weren't the thing that phased you. What does phase you is that for the first time they've actually all come to see you, and that was really nervous, really nerve-wracking. It was for me, anyway. And of course, that first night at Wembley, you know, the sequence are packed up, and I just have got one of those moments like in Jaws, you know, when they sort of pan in and or track out and pan in on Roy Scheider. When I looked across at Mike and he was going, because nothing was happening, he was going, it's all gone. It's all gone Pete Tong. And so, you know, so I just sort of launched into a bit of a bass thing and then into Mr. Pink, which we did, which gave the techs time to sort of come up and fix whatever the problem was. And that sort of became, that's something that the fans sort of talk about, you know, they say, do you remember that bloody awful bit in the middle of the gig? Okay, yeah, I did actually. Yeah, it was. It certainly was for me, and I think that for the fans too. You know, a lot of the hardcore fans, I think they'd gone through that period of, because they'd all been with us right from the beginning, and then there was that sort of slightly tricky period when we were having, you know, hit singles, which wasn't very hip really, to be having hit singles, because you can't be sort of serious jazz funk and have hit singles as well. The two things aren't supposed to go. So, you know, we had the there were that branch of the fans who were sort of going, well, you know, they've all sold out now and they're all much too big, but they all came along to the Wembley thing, and I think that the transition for us was pretty good, actually. As I said, we went on to do quite a few nights there and a lot of the big arenas. I mean, it was the sort of the late 80s, and so arena touring was the thing to do if you could do it. I mean, not every band could do it, and it was amazing that we could. But by this time, of course, we'd had such a good catalogue of records, you know, with Polydor, that there was so much stuff to be choosing from that it wasn't a problem for us sort of putting together one set and then another set and another set. We could always try and keep it interesting, you know, with the emphasis always being on the fact that we tried to play as well as we could, you know. Which I have to say too is that one of the great things about this particular concert is how fantastic Boone Gould is on guitar. You know, he's really underrated, I think. You know, not least by the guys in the band, I think, but Boone was so unique as a guitarist. And every time I hear it, it sort of brings a tear to my eye. So he's top man. No, it's, you know, for us, there is actually a choreography to the way that the shows has to go. And I don't mean dancing-wise, but I mean that the way that the lights work, with the way that the sound engineer knows that there are cues where he can put delays on things. And therefore, it's not quite so jazz that, that you can just, depending on what mood you're in, just hit the whatever song you want. Because it's just not how it works. And especially if you actually have to use sequencing on stage, which we use to bolster the keyboard parts. Because, of course, having both Mike Lynham and Wally Badgeroo playing keyboards in the studio and laying up, as very much was the sound of Level 42, with these multi-synths and lots of sequencing and sort of sequence bass lines and clavinet parts, all of which would be completely impossible for Mike Lynham to cover in one bass. So he'd sit there with the Rhodes and putting in these sort of carrying the solos and the top sounds, but there's a sequence of chugging along in the background doing all the wicky-wacky clavinet stuff. And when you've got that, you know, you may well have a feeling to say, I'll tell you what, fellas, let's do Mr. Pink again. The sequencer goes, well, I don't know that one, I'm going to play this song, because they're a bit thick like that, you know. Yeah, I do. I love playing the songs, you know. They've been really, I keep saying it, but they have been fantastic vehicles for the way that I play bass guitar for a start, and, you know, for just the kind of Level 42-ness of the music. I still sort of maintain that it is quite unique in that respect. And the songs, are, you know, because we did make a lot of albums, and you know, we were very lucky too to have actually come through in the early 1980s when our original contract with the record company was for 5 albums. I mean, these things just don't happen anymore. But what it does do, it gives you a chance as a musician to really grow and expand and build up a body of work. And so you have lots and lots of different songs that you can, you know, that you can pull out the hat. And some of the ones that I enjoy playing most today, you know, that I'm going to be playing tonight, are the songs from 1982 and, you know, 1983 and 1984. Things like True Believers and Eyes of Water Falling. And the fans enjoy it too, you know. So it will be easy for me to sell, you know, the big hits and stuff. And I really enjoy playing those too. There's no doubt about it. And they've been very good to me and the guys. But, you know, it's all good stuff. I can honestly hand on my heart and say I can't think of any songs that I really don't like playing after all these years. But that's because I'm senile. I can't remember. I expect to hate them all.
Thank you. in every town. But I don't mind, that's the way she wants to be. There's something about her that reminds me of me. She's my soulmate, we'll be together till the sun goes down.
Congratulations, you have found the extra hidden extra, which is part of this fabulous DVD. These are some of the guys that go to make the show together. This is Joey Jowett, who does monitors for us. And this is Adam, who is the world's number one drum tech, except when he's not with us, when he's not the number one. He's just another drum tech. And this is the stage. We're actually on stage here at the, what's this place called? The Astoria. This is Kevin Hopgood, my tour manager. Hello. Kev looks after me and Kylie Minogue. And I know who he'd rather look after, frankly.
Right.
I don't blame you, mate. So this is my brother Nathan's rig. And I expect he got it cheap because he doesn't like spending much money, no? Look at this main man. Who's back there on drums? It's Gary Husband, of course. There he is. Top man. Greatest drummer for the greatest drum tech. Adam wouldn't work with anybody else. That's why we had to get the Gary in. Over here, this is my rig. And this is my rig. I've got some effects up here. And I use two amps because this amplifier runs these cabinets for the guys that you hear out there in the audience. And this bottom one runs my monitors, so I kind of have the same sound, because otherwise I'm stood a bit far away, and then I have to turn it up too loud, and the other guys don't like it. This is Lyndon Connor's keyboard spot, and this is where he does all his high-pitched singing, and all of that stuff that he does on his keyboards. And back there, I don't know if you can see in the shadows, can you wave, Johnny, and smile?
Hello.
This is Johnny McCauley, and he looks after my bass guitars. If you ever wander over and you'll see, I hope you've got some light back here.
Not really.
You got no, plug one of those things in and light down. Yeah, I'll stick this.
Yeah.
We'll plug light in for you. Ah, you see? We're not tarty, are we? Well, you can have it back now, Johnny.
Thank you very much.
It wasn't very exciting, was it? Yeah, you were great. How was I? And that's it. That's what goes to make Level 42 in 2005. And I really hope you've enjoyed the Live at Wembley DVD. And I'm so glad that Universal got it together and put it out, because it's a corker. But the best is yet to come. Bye-bye.